So I've recently seen a lot of videos of people running games on stock hardware since the video card shortage. So I wanted to actually put some Intel chipsets to the test in VR, meaning no video card, just the onboard graphics. And I'm gonna just go over what I basically found. Now, I originally wanted to do this tutorial with the Intel UHD 750, but even though Windows Mixed Reality said it was compatible, I could not get it to sync up or link up. I tried the Windows Mixed Reality headset and the software that came with it. I also tried the Oculus software and the Quest 2 Link and Air Link, and it just would not connect. Now, keep in mind, I used, if my memory serves me correctly, it was a Elite Desk 800, HP 800 G8 Mini. Now, that's not to say that the SFF or full tower would not work. I don't know, because I do not know how they clock the chips or how they make them a little differently for the minis. So I decided to go the laptop route and try a Z Book instead, a G8 Z Book. Now, the onboard graphics for the Z Book is an iRIS Xe, which is actually supposed to be better than the 750 according to benchmark sites. So this is what I found. As you can see from the footage, I'm just showing off the chip so you know exactly what I'm using and what the specs are of the system. I only have 16 gigs of RAM in this laptop, so that may hinder it a little bit, but right now we're just trying to see what loads, what works, what doesn't, etc. According to Windows Mixed Reality, it will work on some VR. I went ahead and ran the SteamVR performance test also. And the frames looked great. It looked great on the screen, but after the results, it basically said, no, you can't use any of it. So hopefully I can prove it wrong. I'm gonna just run through real quick what did and didn't run. Let me go through the ones that flat out didn't load, meaning they crashed immediately when I tried to start them. Horde Attack didn't load. Spider-Man Far From Home didn't load. Air Car actually didn't load. I thought that would, considering it's kind of low requirement. And since we're on the topic of low requirements, Zooma VR didn't load, Altspace VR didn't load, and last but not least, Moss didn't load. Now, Moss, that's a higher requirement game. I was not surprised that that didn't load. Now to talk about games that loaded but froze shortly after. Portal Stories VR loaded and then froze. Gorn loaded and then flat out froze. And last but not least, Star Wars Droid Repair froze, which that one I was very surprised that it froze because I was able to use that on my Gear VR. They had a mobile version for it, and it's also very low requirement. And here's just a quick clip of one of the errors that I got on Portal Stories because I was able to actually capture it. That had two separate driver errors. Now on to the stuff that actually did load. I was extremely surprised what worked versus what didn't. Basically, everything I thought was gonna work didn't work, and everything that I thought wasn't gonna work actually worked. And you're gonna see what I mean by this. So VRChat actually worked. It was slow, and I had to baby it a little bit, but it worked. It didn't crash. I could go in and say hi to people. Now, when I first entered the world, my frame rate was really, really bad. And then if you just stand still and count to 10, it's like, okay, I can look around, I can move around, we're good to go. But yeah, my avatar loaded, and I even went into I tried to find a large crowd of people and have them throw some particle effects around. And it still didn't crash. It was able to process it. So I don't know if it's how it does the calculations or how it was programmed, but props, it actually worked on this standalone chip. It actually worked on the stock iRIS Xe chip. And special thanks to everybody that allowed me to be in there and record using an iRIS Xe chip. Another game that worked great was SuperHot. SuperHot worked flawless. I did not even realize I was using a stock graphics. Probably wasn't the best resolution, but it actually did work and work well. I had so much fun, I actually hit the wall with my controller because I forgot that I was doing the testing. I was actually enjoying myself playing the game. And on to the last one that I got working, Half-Life Alyx actually loaded and worked and did not crash. Now, this one is not playable. I could load it, I could get in, I could look around, but it just, the frame rate was so low, it wasn't enjoyable, I couldn't really play it. I got really sick really fast just because of the frame rate and the lag and everything else. So if you're just doing it for testing, sure, and you may be able to modify your settings a little bit in-game if you guys have low setting mods to get it working better. But yeah, as a standalone jumping in and playing it, it's not gonna work. Now, a lot of these not working may be due to either bad programming or just the fact that they never considered using an Intel graphics chip for their game or program. So I basically made this video to see if it was viable to just take your standard laptop and a Windows Mixed Reality headset and use that for mobile VR. And also to see if we could get around getting these big expensive video cards for VR. As far as price-wise goes, just get a Quest 2. They're $300, and the standalone VR, you'll have a decent experience. It doesn't require a $300 video card or a $1,000 headset. Basically, almost all things for SteamVR will not work on this chip, but some of the Windows Mixed Reality stuff will. So Intel graphics still has a long way to go. I don't think Intel has ever had gaming as a priority for their onboard graphics chips. If social VR is going to be a big thing, or even more VR gaming is going to be a big thing, they're gonna probably have to get on board. Until next time, have a great one.